start getting this going while it's still a little bit cool in here before it gets too hot, right? Alrighty, a few announcements this morning. We have a youth group tonight at 6 o'clock at Lacey's house. Starting season two of The Chosen. So grades 6 through 12 are all welcome. If you want to have any questions, go ahead and see Lacey or Connie or Frank after service. But looking forward to that tonight at 6 o'clock, dinner, and Chosen started season two. And then downstairs, Hannah and Pam have been working diligently downstairs during this month while Five Seas is out to get painting done and cleaning done and stuff. They're just kind of redoing everything. I know they've had some help. They only announced that they are going to be back there again tomorrow morning at 9, and then again on Tuesday if necessary at 9 to finish the painting. And if after the painting is all done, then they'll be scheduling deep cleaning and sanitizing and all kinds of stuff before, and trying to get it all done and everything back together before all the kids come back. So if you're available to help, please be here tomorrow morning and meet Pam and Hannah at 9 o'clock to help with painting downstairs. And they're also looking still for a crew to help with scaffolding and stuff on the weekend. Just see Pam about that if you are able to do that. And then, next weekend, yes, this is now a week from today already, is our church barbecue. It's going to be at 3 o'clock in the afternoon out at Connie's house. We are providing grilled chicken and water and stuff, but we'd love you to be there and to have an end of the summer party together. Bring your lawn chairs, bring your beverages, and bring a potluck dish to share. And so having another potluck. And I'm starting to think I'm back at the Lutheran church. But anyways, it's fun. It's going to be a great time. We're going to have Connie from having the slip and slide set up. We're going to have the plunger contest, which she clarified last week. They're going to be clean toilet plungers. And a race is what it is. Yard games, just all kinds of fun. This is a great way to just celebrate the end of the summer together. And then we're going to end the evening with fireside worship around the fire pit and stuff. So that'll be a great time. And is that all of my announcements that I can remember? Yeah, that is. Thank you. Awesome. So this morning, let's go ahead and stand. We're going to start our worship with House of the Lord, because there is joy here today. No matter what you're feeling, no matter what you're thinking, no matter what's going on, there's always joy in the House of the Lord.
Thank you.
part of an online worship leaders summit thing. It was called Worship Circle. And it was online via Zoom. And my small group leader that I got to be in a small group with was Christine DeMarco. And if you don't know who that is, she's the one that wrote it as well, that we sing a lot. And there was other Christian artists there that led small groups, like Matt Maher and Paul Loesch and Meredith Andrews, Natalie Grant. It was really amazing, and I was very thankful for this. And after our small group, where we got to speak and talk one-on-one with Christine, there was like 12 of us. And in my small group, there was women there. There was one from Scotland, two from the UK, actually, and then from all over the United States, Florida, a woman from Oregon, Minnesota, South Carolina. But it was just amazing. And the main session, the last hour, was with 160 worship leaders from all over the world. And we got to listen to speakers. And Meredith Andrews is one of the speakers. And what she talked about was us as worship leaders, and it's just people in the kingdom of God, that we are not alone and that we are loved. And that was the main kind of message that they were trying to get all of us as worship leaders and as people, that we are not alone and that we are loved, and to lean in on God. And it's so cute. Anyways, sorry. Exactly. You don't want to do that with me. Anyways, so her main thing was bringing the kingdom of God, or the kingdom of heaven to earth, which is one thing that we talk a lot about in this church. And she says that Jesus was always talking about the kingdom, and that our identity is in that kingdom. And to have success in the kingdom of God is to be obedient. It looks like for us, it's not having all the money, all the cars, all the houses that the world thinks of success. For us, bringing the kingdom of God, to be in the kingdom of God, is to be obedient and to lean on Him and to know God. And that's kind of what Doug was talking about last week in John 17, about when Jesus said, this is eternal life, to know God and to know me. And so I want to read a couple of these verses that she gave really quick before we get into our last two songs. And because she talked about that no matter how we're feeling, of course, and we talk about this a lot too, no matter how your body is, we are all tired, we are all weary, and there's things going on, but yet we still take on that sacrifice of worship and praise in whatever way that we know, and we put that out there to Him, to do that for Him, to sacrifice and to bring people by our worship and praise and our examples into the kingdom of God. So 2 Corinthians 4:16 through 18 says, therefore we do not lose heart, though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen, since what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. And then she went on in Hebrews, and was speaking out of Hebrews. Excuse me. So Hebrews 12:1-2 says, therefore, since we are surrounded by such a huge crowd of witnesses to the life of faith, that's the heroes of our faith, she says, that is that crowd of all those thousands of generations that have gone before us, they're up there cheering us on. Let us strip off every weight that slows us down, especially the sin that so easily trips us up. And let us run with endurance the race God has set before us. We do this by keeping our eyes on Jesus, the champion who initiates and perfects our faith. Because of the joy awaiting Him, He endured the cross, disregarding its shame. Now He is seated in the place of honor beside God's throne. And then going on to verse 26 of Hebrews 12. When God spoke from Mount Sinai, His voice shook the earth, but now He makes another promise. Once again, I will shake not only the earth, but the heavens also. This means that all of creation will be shaken and removed, so that only unshakable things will remain. So since we are receiving a kingdom that is unshakable, let us be thankful and please God by worshiping Him with holy fear and awe. Let's do that now. So you continue with Hymn of Heaven and just listen to the lyrics of these next two songs and reflect on those verses. Thank you.
Even when my eyes can't see, and the sound. Jackson's going to come up and lead us in communion.
Listen to a sermon. Jesus was washing the disciples' feet, and what he told them was, you've already had a bath, you're mostly clean, it's just your feet are dirty. And so we're basically clean, we're all saved, we're going to heaven, but when you walk through this life, you can't help but get your feet dirty. Things that you say, things that you think, regrettable exchanges with other people. So we're basically clean, we just need to wash our feet. And I just think that we need to take a little bit of time, self-examine, and let Jesus wash your feet.
Thank you.
Jackson, and I am the youngest of six kids. Everyone knows my wife, Kathy. She's locally famous. She's lived here her whole life. Except for when I drug her to catch camp for a few years. But so I have three kids, Joe, Luke, and Joy, and eight grandkids, and three of those are shared by Dale and Candy. Actually, our oldest granddaughter is heading off to college. That's how you know that you're a little old. She's going to Vanguard, leaving on Tuesday. I guess another way you know you're a little older is I just had my 50th class reunion. And I didn't know whether I should go to the reunion or to the care center. So, I don't know how many of you guys know this, but I went to San Jose Bible College, and I actually have a degree in Bible and theology with a minor in pastoral care. And it's helped me hang sheetrock for the last 47 years. But San Jose Bible College was a really good decision for me. My parents really wanted me to go there. And, you know, I just didn't pay enough attention during Sunday school class. And I needed to get a background and so that I would know God. And actually, there was a time in my life where I was saying, okay, if this is true, I'm going to follow it for my whole life. And if it's not true, I want to abandon it right now and get on with my life. And after going to Bible college, I was convinced that this is the right way to go. There's two big decisions you make in your life. And the first one is whether or not you're going to follow God. And the second one is who you're going to marry. And I hit a home run on both of them. When I was down in San Jose Bible College, I'd never played basketball before except for intramurals or whatever. And I had the opportunity to play basketball and meet some great people. One of the guys was Bryce Jessup. We actually became friends over the years. I've said this before, we got married right here. My wife and I were the first people getting married in this church in 1978. I also taught youth group here back in the day. And Janet Cook was in my youth group, right, Janet?
Sure.
Are you telling me you weren't?
Yeah, you and Jamie.
Okay.
Jamie Pott.
Jamie Pyle self teach it too, as well.
I think I was younger.
What's that?
I think it was my sister Joy was in your youth group.
Okay. Well, I just remember you and, was it Scott? Okay. Anyway, we'll move on from that one. I did teach the youth here for a while. Also, I don't know if any of you guys knew this, but my wife and I went to San Jose and picked up Dave Stram and brought him here back in the day. And a couple other things I want to bring up was back in the day, this church had a pretty good basketball team. And it was Jamie Piles and I, and Dale joined later. Don Bowers was on it. And I remember Bill Spencer. He was in his 50s when we were still playing, and he was probably 55, and he had a game where he couldn't miss, and we were playing a group of kids that were half our age, and every time Bill would get the ball, they'd yell shooter and run over and try and stop him, and he scored about 30 points that day. So, I mean, we had some ball players back in the day, and I also, another reason that I have in this church was some of the people that question, who can tell me without looking up anything what the sermon was 2 weeks ago? Tell me. Anybody? 2 weeks ago. Okay. You're the winner. Mike, what? John 16. My point is that sometimes sermons are like meals. They sustained you when you ate them, and they were a good thing, but you can't remember everyone that you ever heard. But I want to talk about three sermons through the years that I remember that I could never forget. And the first one's kind of a funny one because I have no idea what the sermon actually was. All I know is this introduction grabbed me, and every now and then I still think about it. And we were up in Ketchikan, and we had a guy named Frank Lodgett who worked for the Forest Service, and he was about this tall, red-headed, quirky kind of guy, and he was a associate pastor of the church up there, and he was, when he worked for the Forest Service, he was part of a bear relocation group. So there was a grizzly bear causing havoc in town, and they put out a cage, and they tranquilized it, and they put it on an airplane, and they were going to fly it to an island. And while it was in the air, it came back to life. And what happened was, eventually, it came at them. They crashed the plane in the water. The bear drowned, and they were recovered. But it was one of those sermons that I remember nothing after the illustration to start. The second one is a lot better one. Roy Hicks Sr. Roy Hicks Sr. Had a sermon one time, and it was called about instrument-rated Christians. And he made Christianity compared it to flying a plane. And so when he first learned to fly a plane, you know, you have an instructor with you the whole time, and then later on you get to go out for a solo, and you're up in the air, but you can only go up on a beautiful day, no wind, no minimal amount of clouds, no turbulence. And he said, that's like a new Christian, you know. But you need to become an instrument-rated Christian. And his point was, you need to know the Bible so that when there's turbulence, when there's problems, when you're not familiar with the airport that you need to land on, when, you know, the storms of life come at you, you need to be instrument rated. You need to know your Bible enough so when these storms of life come at you, you're prepared for them. And I thought it was a great illustration, and somehow it captured me, and always remember that sermon as one of the best sermons I've heard. The third sermon that I heard that was memorable, that has stuck with me, was also in Ketchikan. And there was a guy named Richard Harvey that came through. And the day before he gave a sermon, he asked the ladies of the church to give a sacrificial gift. And that gift was, bring me your best face. And some of these faces that he was given were, you know, worth $300, $400, $500, beautiful faces. And he lined them up in front of the church. And then he told the story about a man. And every time that man sinned, he would grab a hammer, go up, and smash a vase. And it gave you, it was kind of like an Old Testament prophet, where you, the illustration was, how much it grieved God every time there was sin, how much it destroyed something beautiful to 1,000 pieces when you sin. God God's perspective of something being destroyed by sin. And I know the whole church just groaned every time this guy would sin again, and he'd walk over some, and he lined them up so that every one was more beautiful than the last one. And that was a sermon that I'll never forget, God's perspective about sin, how much it hurts and how much it destroys. The same Richard Harvey also wrote a book. In his book, it was called 70 Years of Miracles. And since I'm almost 70 years old, I was thinking and contemplating about how has God worked in my life over the last 68 years, and thinking about the different things where God intervened. And my wife and I we pray a lot. We find that there's so many things in our life that we cannot control. And the older you get, the more you realize that we have to depend on God for almost everything. You know, our health and well-being, everything, we're dependent upon God. And so we pray a lot. But I was thinking about the different times that God has intervened in my life. And the times when I know that God answered prayers. Now I want to give a little disclaimer here. I don't think I'm special. I don't think I'm better than anyone else. And I know that you have stories that are just as good as the ones that I'm going to tell. And a couple of these stories actually make me look good. And I apologize for that. It is how it happened. And I'm not any better than anybody else, but I have had times where I've done the right thing, and it will come up in the story. But the first story I want to tell is a pretty simple story. And it's my wife is pregnant, overdue, with Luke, and she is at her end. And she asks me, she says, "We need to pray that this baby comes." And so, is that the music that says I'm done? I know the Oscars, you know, once you hear that music, you can't stop. Well, so we prayed that this baby would come. And I asked Kathy after we prayed, I said, "Now what thing would you want to get done? What thing would you want to do before the baby came?" And she said, "Well, I definitely want to have my dishes done." I said, "Well, you better go do them." And my wife went over and did the dishes, and while she was doing the dishes, the water broke, and the baby came. The second story I want to is my dad and mom. They were people of faith, and I swear, when you're poor, you pray a lot more than people that are rich. I'm telling you, we were poor, and my dad, we prayed about everything. But my dad, I think he was probably in his late 70s, maybe early 80s, he decided to go visit my sister in Michigan. And he bought an old 67 Chevy, and it had a camper on the back of it. And so I took it to Jamie Files because I thought, this truck will never make it to Michigan. And Jamie did what he could to fix the car. Well, they took off, and in the middle of nowhere, it started to make a noise. And with that, a little noise is never enough to make him stop the car. It made more noise. And when it got loud enough, he pulled over. And my mom looked at him and said, "What are we going to do now?" And my dad replied, "I'm hungry. Let's go in back. Make me a sandwich." And that's just how my dad was. And you got to remember, they're in the middle of nowhere, and Dad, I don't know that he ever owned a credit card. There's no cell phones. And so they're praying and they're eating a sandwich. guy says, "Are you guys in trouble here, or what's going on?" And they said, "Yeah, I think the rear end went out on our vehicle." And the man said, "Well, come on over to my house. I'll drive you over there, and let's talk." And so they went over there, and he said, "Oh yeah, my son owns a wrecking yard about 20 miles away. I'll give him a call." And, you know, finding the rear end to a 67 Chevy in the middle of nowhere, and he replaced it, no charge, and my parents drove away. And it just shows God's provision. But my wife also and I always felt like my dad had more guardian angels than anybody. Okay, now this is the story that kind of makes me look good. I'm sorry about that. When I was in college, I had a 69 Chevelle, and I loved that car. It was silver on the outside, black interior, and I made payments on it. There was very many cars that I made payments on, but I had just finished the last payment when I got a letter from my mom. We used to write letters back then. And in my mom's letter, she told me how their car broke down. And so God started convicting me. How can I have a really nice car and be in college and my parents have a old broke down car? So I came home for Christmas, and I was wrestling with God because I was saying, "God, if I can't get this car up, I have a job." You know, it was on Bascom and Stevens Street, 10 miles from the college, and I need to go back and forth to work. And how do I get back to Bible college to start with? And right before I was ready to go home after Christmas break, I said, "Mom, you need to take me to the freeway." And my mom said, "Why?" And I said, "Because I don't have a car." And she said, "You don't have a car?" And I said, "No, I'm giving my car to you." And you'd have to know how sweet my mom was, but she started crying, everything that I'd hoped for. And she took me to the freeway. So my first ride, we lived in Springfield at the time, my first ride took me to Crestwell exit. There I got picked up by a guy in Camaro, green Camaro, and he said he was going to San Francisco. And he stopped for gas in Redding, and in the service station I saw someone that I knew from San Jose. So I hopped in the car with him, and that was my quickest trip that I ever made from here to San Jose. And I hitchhiked. And so I said, "Okay, God, thank you for that. That's step one. Now I need a car." And so I had been looking around, and there was a 57 Volkswagen that had sat in the same spot for a long, long time. And I finally worked up the nerve, and I opened the door, and I looked at the registration, and I found out where they lived. And I knocked on their door, and they said, "Yeah, it's been broke down for a long time. I've actually had an airplane mechanic look at it, and they can't fix it." And he said, "You can have it for $40. So I gave him $40. A 57 Volkswagen is kind of cool. It looks like a German helmet. The back of it came back like this, and had a little tiny window in the back. And like I said, I worked at a service station, so I changed the oil, I charged up the battery, and for $13, I was able to put a clutch in it. And I drove for the next 2 years, and got great mileage, could loan it out to people. And the other thing about that Volkswagen was, at the end of 4 years, actually five, sorry, of college, I graduated, and I owed $270, and I sold that Volkswagen for $270, and paid off the end of my tuition, and saw God's provision in my life. And it's just one of those times where you go, "God met me, God helped me." You you know, I prayed and he answered. In 1979, well, if you can remember those times, they were Jimmy Carter was in office. Interest rates were 21%. I didn't have any work anymore. And I had just built a house on King's Road. I decided if I was laid off from work, I at least ought to do something. I built a house I couldn't pay for. And at that time, we had the missionaries, the Fleeners, asked us to watch John Fleener so he could get a license at our house. And so John was at our house, and we taught him how to drive, which was kind of interesting. He was from Japan. And but when the Fleeners came back, it was Julius and, what was her name, Virginia Fleener, and they prayed a prayer at our house. And it was, you know, sometimes we just pray and sometimes people pray, and there's a difference. And they prayed for us, and they prayed that we would be blessed. And I remember at that time, Gene Tate was building 5 houses in the neighborhood, and I thought, I have to get those houses. I don't have any money. And I bid on these houses $450 a piece to hang, tape, texture, house in a garage. And you know, that's pretty cheap. And she just took my bid and shopped it, made the people that actually did drywall for it already do it cheaper. And we were in trouble. Well, after that prayer, Stephen was a pastor here, and he ran into a guy named Mel Stalmaugh at a lumber yard. And Mel Stalmaugh was up in Ketchikan, Alaska, and he needed a drywall contractor. And so I contacted him, and soon I had a ticket to go to Ketchikan to work. Well, we had no money. I went to Ketchikan with $100 and a jar of peanut butter. And the reason the jar of peanut butter was, I felt like, you know, I could live. It was a 2-week job that I was going up there for, and I said I could live for 2 weeks on peanut butter if I had to. If I can afford a loaf of bread, we'll be fine, you know. And when I got there, I didn't realize that the church nearby that we were going to go to, called Clover Pass Church, they had a school, a gymnasium, and all this drywall on, but no paper. And so we moved to Alaska, and it was an answer for their prayers and our prayers, and we were able to pay for the lot. We borrowed the money for the lot on that house from Lloyd and Theta, and God provided us a place and a way to make money. When I was writing this, I was thinking, this sounds like either your life story or an obituary, and I wasn't quite sure. So, while we were there, here's another crazy story. So, we lived in a duplex behind the church. I think Bill visited us in that duplex behind the church. And sometimes when a missionary would come, they would meet, we would feed them a meal. And so, my wife decided to invite the missionaries over, and we needed extra chairs. So I went over to the church to get some chairs, and just like always in Ketchikan, it's the rainiest place in North America. Averages 144 inches of rain a year. And so I got the chairs, I was holding them above my head, running back over to the house, jumped in my puddle, hit the chairs on the top of my head, and threw my neck out, worse than it's ever been thrown out. And I had so much work at the time, and I just remember thinking, I cannot sleep. And I just prayed all night long, God, how am I going to do the work tomorrow? What am I going to do? I know I have to be there, and I can hardly move, and I'm in so much pain. But I got up the next morning at 7 o'clock, and got in the car just as though I was going to be able to get some work done. And as I was sitting there, it was raining like crazy, the wind blowing, and the rain coming at you 40 miles an hour. And there was, at the viewpoint, a hippie standing there in the sunlight. And he had hair down here, ragged clothes, and I thought, I think I'm going to pick him up. And I picked him up, and he said, his name was David Weaver. And I said, David, what do you do for a living? And he says, I do water tests in necks and backs. And I go, what? Necks and backs? He goes, yeah, I do necks and backs. And I said, God sent it to me. So I took him to his Quonset hut. He had a little tin building, and he sat me down on a stool, and he says, you know I'm not authorized to do this. And I said, I don't care. And he felt along my back, and he goes, that's the one that's out right there. And he popped my neck, and I had instant relief. And it was one of those things where I didn't know if I was happier that God cared so much, or that I felt good enough to go to work. But I just went out of there rejoicing. It was amazing. God's provision, God's answer to prayer. Another story that I want to tell is a little recent. About a year and a half ago, my wife went to bed just for a normal checkup. And while they were there, they said she had a heartburn. And so she needed to go to a specialist. And we went from one to the next to the next. And everyone was saying, yeah, it'll probably be some kind of microsurgery. It shouldn't be a big thing. And then we finally went to David Duke, who was our surgeon. And David explained that it was going to be open heart surgery. And I just remember Kathy and I just looking at each other going, oh, no. And so we prayed, the church prayed. And one of the things that my wife loves her dad more than anybody in the world, but Dick Cook reminds her so much of her dad. She had Dick come over and pray. And Dick prayed for her, and it was a powerful prayer. It was a beautiful prayer. And the day before you're going to have open heart surgery, you think you could go to sleep? No. I was braced for the worst. I was thinking, this is going to be so tough. But my wife slept all night, and here's her day of surgery. In 1 hour, she's going to be cut open. She's out watering her flowers. That's her priority right there. On the way to the doctor, my wife stopped at a garage sale. And she bought something. This is her being about to be rolled away in a gurney. And I'm just telling you, prayer. I want to bring up first is Proverbs 3:5. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him, and He will make your path straight. Let's go on to the next scripture. And this is from Hebrews 11. It says, and it is impossible to please God without faith. Anyone who wants to come to Him must believe that He exists and that He rewards those who diligently seek Him. And the third scripture is, seek first the kingdom of God, and all these things will be added unto you, and His righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. And I was thinking about the scriptures that I love, and they're pretty much all say the same thing. Pretty much what they say is, seek, follow, trust, go after God, and He's going to help you out. He's going to be here with you. He's going to answer your prayers. And so we try to live our life like that. You know, one of the things that I think is so cool that Paul Randall has done and my wife has tried to do from time to time, and that is think about something that you can do that's eternal. In this life, there's not very many things that we do that are eternal. But my wife, and I know she was influenced by Paul, to think about what it is that you can do each day that's eternal. John MacArthur has said something that sounds really simple, but I think it's profound. And what he said is, life is so daily. And it's true. We make a decision to follow God, but life is so daily. You need to get up every day and make that same decision. One decision back there a long time ago is great. But every day wake up and go, today I'm going to follow God. Today I'm going to follow an example set by Paul Randall. I'm going to do something, try and do something today that's eternal. So I just hope that the words that I've said give you some kind of encouragement to understand that God's still working. You know, back in the day, we read the Bible and we see that all these miraculous things happen. But they still happen today. You know, over the course of time, any one of you guys can get up here and share some things where God has intervened. And I just want to thank you for allowing me to share my stories and the things where God has blessed me and answered my prayers. I know you have just as many, and I enjoy hearing those from you. Thank you.
To bring
your kingdom here on earth and to bring people closer to you, to know you, to know eternal life. We thank you, Lord, for staying this church. We thank you for Deb and Doug, and just pray that you would bless them as they continue their trip in there and as they travel home later this week. We thank you, Lord, for all of our members here today and our church family. We thank you for, and we ask that you just bless those that cannot be with us today and those that are battling health problems or other problems, Lord. We just ask that you bless them, put people in their lives right now that they can look to and depend on and help and bring you into their lives. We ask these things in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. All right, let's go ahead and stand. We're going to sing Greatest Thy Faithfulness.
Elvis is in the building.
That's right.
Oh.